And it's a little or a lot awkward because you're being a little or a lot vulnerable. It promises something usually, and it feels good. So at the end of the session, we're gonna come back to your messages, leave a few minutes at the end to see what people have sent back to you. So when your donors give to you, bless their hearts, give them great gratitude. Give them love, give them appreciation. And every time you send a thank you note or make a thank you call or send a thank you email, that's actually a story about two people. It's about the person or the polar bear or whatever that's being helped, the problem that the donor is solving. And it's also a story about the wonderful and caring person who gave. This is our friend, the King, Tom Ahern. If you don't follow Tom Ahern from the US, he writes a wonderful newsletter and is a completely amazing Twitter user. And Tom always says, I want to read about me, the donor, not about you, the organization. And great storytelling is always putting donors first. And Tom, whenever we talk to Tom, Tom is always talking about this fundamental truth. And for us, we talk about this as the simple but critical shift from what we do as a charity to what you make possible as a donor. And that's really the heart and soul of donor love, is making the shift as an organization from talking about what we do to talking about what you as a donor make possible. And storytelling should always be about your donors. So here is a really simple Tom Ahern test for you to do with any piece of your donor communications. This is obviously a direct mail letter, but you can do it with a newsletter, with an email, with a website, with a phone script. Take out a red pen and circle every instance of the word you. And when you look at your paper from far away, you want it to look like this. As Tom says, you want it to look like it has the measles. Because this is a very simple visual cue that you're talking more about your donor than you're talking about yourself, which is the crucial to great storytelling that puts donors at the heart of what you're doing. So the red pen test is an easy, easy way for you to visualize whether or not you're talking about your donor or you're talking about your letters. You can use these in thank you notes, as Simon shared yesterday. You can use these messages in all kinds of places to remind your donors of the caring and amazing community of people that they're a part of. And having your donors share their stories with you is such a powerful and underutilized way to build relationships and get stories going both ways between you and your supporters. Reflecting what they care about and talking about the things that matter to them. And it's not your job as a fundraiser to educate or convince someone to give to your cause. People don't give because they're educated or because they're convinced. They give because they're inspired. And the way to inspire people is to share many voices from the chorus of your organization, is to make sure that the voices, donors are hearing voices that resonate with what they think and feel, and that make them feel connected to a larger community of people just like them. And they long to hear stories that talk about putting those voices that sound like them and that feel like them. So too often, organizations write always from the chief executive or from the board chair. Who here in your last fundraising campaign, the main voice was an executive? Oh, good, okay. Program people? What's left?
Supporters,
okay. What's the supporters? What else?
Field workers?
That's good. We've done a lot over the years with very unexpected and strange voices. There's an example on Sophie of a campaign that came from a bird, Ruby the Hummingbird, who talked about nearly colliding with the building. It's a lot of fun and had an excellent result. But I'm going to share one today that I think is even more strange and unexpected. Has anybody seen this? So this is Phil. And Phil is a paper bag. And the food banks in Canada, all of them are, everybody gets a paper bag that's sent in your mailbox. And Phil has the, Phil can say whatever he wants. Phil can do whatever he wants. And Phil can even dress up for Halloween. And so we had this, John and I went on a bit of a tirade, decided all the things that Phil could be. Phil could be a superhero, Phil could be a Jack and Ledger, he could be a Dracula. John was really rooting for Phil with a paper bag, with a paper bag on his head. But Phil the ghost was the one that won out in the end. And the piece that came from Phil for this Halloween campaign, you might not recognize me, it's at the costume, it's me, Phil, the food drive bag. As a paper bag, I don't dress up much. So this Halloween, I'm inspired not only to keep collecting funds and food for our hungry neighbors, but also dress up. I thought of being a superhero like you, as a food bank supporter, a trick-or-treat bag or a jack-o'-lantern, but none of those costumes are very scary. I'll tell you what's really scary, hungry. 1 in 20 households in our region needs a food bank right now. Will you please help? So Phil allowed us to break away from what the organization had been doing for a really, really long time, which was sad pictures of hungry children who needed our help. Who was in Mark Phillips' session yesterday? We talked about pity? Yeah, not very many people actually. And so, yeah, you were? So I thought it was really interesting that Mark talked about moving away from that kind of an approach. And Phil is exactly the sort of example of something just like that, where you can move away from always sounding the same. And when we, whenever we think about the kind of stories that we want to tell and the way we want to be seen, I'm asking fundraisers to think about, what can you do that's unexpected? What's a voice of your organization that your donor or supporter is not used to hearing? I mean, the story of the food bank is pretty consistent, right? There's hungry people, and we need to help them. And we can give them food, or we can give us funds, and we'll feed them. So what are the ways in which you can tell a story that is unexpected, sometimes even surprising, even delightful? And I've had some throwdowns with a couple of fundraising friends, most notably Jeff Brooks in the States, who said that there was no place for humor in fundraising. And I disagree, because I think there are ways in which you can use humor and joy as a way to just break donors out of that kind of sameness of blah, 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 I'm the chief executive, what we do is important, there's still hungry kids, there's still hungry kids, there's still hungry kids, there's still hungry kids. So what are the ways in which you can use unexpected voices? As a charity, what are the ways in which you're inviting your donor to think about giving to you as a part of who they are? As a part of what defines them. What defines me is that I'm a mother and a pet owner and a passionate feminist. And the right charities who can talk to me about how giving to them makes things better for women and girls and dogs and a brighter future are going to do much better, because that will be a part of the story of my life. A part of my legacy will be reflected in all of those things. Very few things make me rage more than people who ask clients and boards who ask us to help them with an elevator pitch. Because who wants to be pitched? Anyone? Ever? Who wants to have a conversation? We want to have conversations. We don't want to be